That's savings, right? And that gap, so we can pump money into our RSP or tax free savings account or whatever it is, the homes significantly outsave us year over year.
For sure. And you know, it's not something to say that appreciation is absolutely guaranteed, because not, right? There's risk in everything. But if, even if we just look at our historical appreciation rate in Canada, it's about 5% year over year when kind of averaged over the stats for the last 40 to 50 years, right? So again, that comes into timing the market. Markets go up, markets go down, but for the most part, if you're in it for the long run, especially where we live in the GTA too, like you just think about kind of all the economic factors, we're really a hub for trade and business and everything. We don't have natural disasters, we don't have wars. Like it's a really safe place to live as well. That's what's driven a lot of the immigration as well. So when you really consider sort of the outlying factors as well, you know, those are things that drive appreciation and have driven it over the last, you know, many decades as well. So yeah, just to touch on what I said, yeah, there's no guarantee it's gonna go up, but
historically,
as history's shown, you know, if you're in it for the long run, which most of us are, you're gonna see some nice appreciation on that property for sure. So touching more on sort of the investment part, like your home is kind of an accidental investment that really does create some leverage opportunities. A couple examples that we have here too is, you know, say you're considering buying versus renting right now, but the financials work and, you know, you're able to secure that first property. Like we said, every month you're paying down your debt on that property. So the difference between how much you own is getting bigger. And, you know, in a couple of years, you can use some of that new equity to trade up. Maybe you have higher incomes in a couple of years, job promotions, job changes, that kind of stuff. You know, that stuff that happens for our first timers here, or in maybe our late mid-20s, as you kind of get along that timeline, you probably will be earning a little more income, and you can use that plus the newfound equity in your home to move up closer to, like we said before, that dream home. The other thing as well is, let's say you've been in your home for 4 to 5 years, you're very happy, you don't need more space, you like your location, all that kind of thing. You can talk with a mortgage professional about leveraging some of that equity, so the debt you've paid down, taking a bit of money from you know, the value of your home and putting that towards a rental property or an investment property. You know,
or even renovating your existing home, right? You buy a home that's not fully your dream home just yet, but 3, 4, 5 years down the line, you know, you've grown that equity, recouping that equity to, you know, finish your basement, or, I mean, you could find that, right, that home that, you know, is in the right location, right size, you know, for your family, but maybe, again, it needs some renovation, it's unfinished basement or something like that. You can eventually get there, mm-hmm. right? You just be patient with it. Myself, we try to do one project a year, and sometimes we have to use that equity, but, you know, we turn that, you know, grubby backyard into a really nice backyard. We turn that grubby basement into a really nice basement, right? But that's stuff you can do as time goes on. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, we're thinking about a rental property. Is there a formula that you can lay out that says you have to have X amount into a property in order for it to carry itself on a positive?
Yeah, so I mean, different for every, I think if we can go into like specifics in terms of monthly cash flow, maybe we can at a later time just for that specifics. But to quickly touch on that, if you currently own a property, a lot of times what people are saying, you may be using savings for this investment property. Minimum down payment on an investment property is 20% by government standards. I do have some tricks and trades around that if need be. So a lot of times what we see people do if they currently own a primary residence is you are allowed to refinance up to 80% of the value of your property for your primary residence. So to use a quick example, to use round figures, let's say I own $1 million home and I have a $500,000 mortgage, I cannot apply to refinance up to 80% of the value of the property. So the money that I can potentially take out of the property would be 80% of the value, so $800,000, less my current mortgage, $500,000. So I could potentially take out $300,000 to use towards the down payment of an investment property. Right, so that's how you kind of leverage what you have right? And for your first-time home buyers in there, if you have the means for mom or dad or anyone out there to help you out, likely they have opened up a significant amount of room that they might be able to help you out, right? They might be able to help you out. And I mean, I talk to a lot of parents, and you know, sometimes people are hesitant to ask their parents for that kind of help and everything like that, but again, if your parents had bought a home 3+, 5+, 10+ years ago, they kind of won the lottery. That was probably the best investment that they ever made. Wouldn't they want that for their child? I mean, you know, in a lot of cases, it's just about having that conversation. So again, I talk to a lot of parents about just, you know, that was a great, you know, I bought this, my home for $350,000 15 years ago, and it's worth $1.2 million. That was a pretty good investment. And now, again, they've opened up all that equity that could be sitting there doing nothing, that they can help their child make that investment.
Yeah,
right?
It's a creative option, right? And, you know, we do talk about down payment options and stuff like that, right? It's not just your savings. It's, you know, maybe it's talking to mom and dad for a different percentage. Right?
Yeah.
But, there's definitely more options than just what's in your bank at this point.
Yeah. And to go through your specific example, I've got pretty good spreadsheets put together that we can discuss at a later date.
Okay.
And to show you kind of like that monthly cash flow, you know, what different scenarios look like. It's just hard to go with it that specifically because, you know, buying a triplex versus buying a condo, or like, there's just different pros and cons to each. I own a triplex, great monthly cash flow, but there's maintenance, there's upkeep, right? So there's three bathrooms, there's three kitchens, there's three tenants, right? It's three times the work as, you know, if I were to buy an investment condo, maybe there's less cash flow there because there's the condo fees involved in it, but set it and forget it, right? So how heavily do you want to be involved as an investor or as a landlord, right? It's really different for everyone, but again, we can talk at a later date and I'll share some spreadsheet stuff with you that can kind of show you the general idea of what the carrying costs would look like. But again, remember, it's pros and cons to both.
Okay, so I think we hammered this a lot, but you know, why pay rent when you can own? And it's not to say that everyone who's considering renting does have the financial means to purchase instead, but it's definitely an option that I encourage everyone who lets me know that you're thinking of renting, let's at least explore it, right? Let's sit down with a mortgage professional, do a pre-approval, look at different areas that might work in terms of commuting, you know, to where your job is or the lifestyle you want. And if it works, you know, hey, at least you have another option for if you're living at home right now and you're considering moving out, at least it's another option rather than just going out and paying rent. Like we said before, paying rent equals building someone else's wealth and paying your mortgage is building your wealth. Whether you're renting or owning, you're going to have a monthly payment. And again, if you can get into that property, you'd much rather have that same monthly payment or a similar monthly payment going towards building your wealth rather than.
And the big thing, if you are renting right now, or living at home, or whatever the case is, and let's say you plan to be for another year, or even 2 years, whatever the case is for you, it's never too early to just go and do a mortgage pre-approval. And the reason I say that is because, one, it's free. Not a lot of things in life are free, but doing a mortgage pre-approval application is free. And if there is something, I don't mind doing a pre-approval for someone looking to buy 2 years down the line. Because if there is something that needs to be just like there's a, you know, a mistake on the credit bureau or we need to save up more debt, at least we can put a plan in place for you. Say, okay, over the next 2 years, you know, save, you know, $300 a month for this long, and then you're gonna have this much saved. I also need you to do this with your credit to, you know, boost it up, whatever the case is, but the longer the amount of time you give me, it gives me more to give to you,
yeah,
to make sure that you are there and we are ready to go at that 6 month mark, 1 year mark, 2 year mark, 5 year mark, whatever it is for you. It is never too early to just do a mortgage pre-approval. Again, it's free.
Yeah, it's great to be proactive, and you know, you can even put kind of a 1-2-3-year plan in place, like on your